Hello there, you multi-tea-tipplers. Welcome to review 354, or 3, not quite sure, I'll annotise. This review is a bit of a departure from what I normally review, but all will become apparent shortly. It's good to explore other things rather than our usual interests, so I'm going to take an opportunity of introducing you to a good old British cup of tea and the Bloodhound SSC. They have something in common, but they're very different things. Let's start with the tea. We all know what a cup of tea is. Most countries around the world have their own version of tea. In China, Chinese green tea is very popular and drunk in considerable volumes, and in Britain, it's fermented tea, brown tea. Oh, I can hear the kettle boiling. Could you excuse me a minute? There we go. That's better. I'll just turn the gas down a little bit, but I won't take it off the boil. First of all, the standard mass consumption British mug of tea. This is what you will find in most homes, at place of work, out in building sites and in offices, etc. And it starts off with a fairly generic ceramic mug and a fairly generic mass-produced tea bag. Now, the idea of the tea bag is simple. You have a paper perforated which will allow the flavour to come out of the tea, the fine ground tea inside, but not let any of the leaves get in to contaminate the brew. So you plop the tea bag in. Most folk are watching their weight, so in goes a couple of sweeteners. Not very nice, but it does give a form of sweetness. And then in goes the boiling water. There we are. It is then noisily stirred and milk is added. Now, the milk can be added before you add the hot water. However, what happens is you change the chemical engagement of the cup of tea. So I recommend that you add milk at the end. Whenever you're making a British style cup of tea, always add your milk at the very end. The tea bag is then, within literally a few seconds, dunked out, squeezed, and then thrown into a bin. What normally happens is that because people don't have particularly good aims, they miss the bin and they hit the wall behind the bin and leave a great big brown blotch, but nobody seems to mind because it's all part of the culture. Now, that's all very well. It's functional. It's not exactly an artisan experience, if you know what I mean. So we'll just put this cup of tea aside, because although this is what the majority of British people consume, it isn't actually the best quality of experience. If you are visiting Britain, and I do mean not just England, but England, Scotland, Ireland and Wales, all five countries in the British Isles, whatever, consume tea in large quantities, and you will find there is increasingly, along with the specialist coffee shops, you're now getting artisan or craft tea shops, but what you're looking for are the independent ones. I will now show you how to make a proper traditional British cup of tea. Now, you're spoiled for choice when it comes to tea bags, and so many of choices of tea, and most of these teas do come in tea bag form, and they like to use the word organic on it because it's relatively easy to apply and it sells the tea. However, you've got to watch, you know, these boxed teas, because you know, they tend to be a bit more expensive. They can have a flavour, but they don't necessarily have the real quality of tea experience you're looking for. So I think we can knock out the pure chamomile. I can get rid of that. TikTok Reboost tea, very handy if you want to avoid tannins and caffeine. get rid of that. And here we have the chamomile. Oh, this is lemon and ginger. I thought it was chamomile. Lemon and ginger infusion teas. Very much part of the flavoured tea market. We don't need. And raspberry leaf. Well, not a fan of that. What I am a fan of are these three teas here. Let's start with the end one. Pure green tea. This is Twinings, which is a big name in British tea. And you will find it if you're in the departure, going through the departure lounges at airports, Heathrow in particular. It's quite well known. The quality is all right, but you can get better because it's still a relatively large market. So, you know, of tea, Twinings, fairly kind of volume production. But green tea, very good for your health. Just check it out online. If it's good for the Chinese, well, it's good for the rest of us. We love this stuff. One of my favourites. This is the phenolic tea, Lapsang Souchong. You mainly get it in the form of tea bags. If you can find it as loose tea from a specialist tea importer, it's one of the finest tea experiences you're going to get. Take my advice, do not add milk. That die-hard British tradition of adding milk to tea. You don't do it with Lapsang Souchong. Again, a fermented tea. Next, we get to this kind of expensive oolong, fine Chinese tea. This particular one, Big Red Robe, Da Hong Pao, or oolong tea. Very nice, but you have to use quite a lot of leaf to get the strength of flavour. And this is actually get something in common with this, which is finest quality green Japanese tea. With green teas, I recommend that when you're making them, do not use boiling water. Let the bottled water boil as it normally would, and then let it cool off for about 15 to 20 seconds. If not 30 seconds, let the water cool down a little before you add it to the leaf, because when the water's too hot, it drives off the flavour from the leaf and it reduces the quality of the experience. So not boiling water, make sure it's off the boil. Wonderful stuff.
There you go.
And now for a traditional British cup of tea, the likes of what you should expect, the likes of which you should expect, excuse my grammar, which you should expect in a quality tea room anywhere in Britain, but generally in the south of England where they're kind of more kind of in tune with these things. So let me see, we're going to, coming up, yeah, there we go, let's get our kettle back on the boil. This was working a few minutes ago. There we go, that's it on the go now. Teapot, an essential requirement. The British are potty, excuse the pun, for teapots. I'm using a silver teapot because for the simple reason, when you drop it, it doesn't smash. And there's a half a chance you might get some of your tea back if you drop the pot. What we do need to do before we put tea in that pot is preheat it with boiling water. We also need a teacup and a saucer and a spoon, not a mug. We need our milk jug, cow's milk, goat's milk, ewe's milk, generally cow's milk, semi-skimmed, and rather than loose sugar, the good old sugar lump. Very much a British institution, along with the, what are these called? Sugar tongs. Sugar tongs. I knew my granny had told me. Sweeteners, throw away the sweeteners, get rid of them. You do not use sweeteners in traditional British cup of tea, done properly. What else will you require? You will require a tea strainer, because we're not using a tea bag here, we are using loose leaf tea. This is traditional English breakfast tea. And what you need to do is assign a spoon to your tea caddy, because if you use different size spoons, you'll get different strengths of tea, and basically you'll end up with tea too weak or too strong. So always stick to using the one type and size of spoon in your tea caddy. We're just waiting for the kettle to boil. Oh yes, it's a whistling kettle. We love it. It's all part of the ceremony. The Japanese have a very articulate, methodical and precise tea ceremony, because the purpose is as much the form as the function. With British tea, it's kind of reversed. It's more functional, but you mustn't forget the form, and the form requires the evidence of a boiling kettle. I'll turn this off now. Boiling water into the teapot, not just a little bit, a good dollop. Swirl it around and then get rid of the water. At this point, you add the tea. Turn this round about. 2 heaped teaspoons will be enough tea for 3, possibly 4 cups. You then, because it's about 20 seconds now since that kettle boiled, you add, but remove your spoon, add the water to the teapot. My advice, and this is a small detail, is always use a wooden spoon to stir the tea, for the very simple reason that metal spoons are amazing at removing the heat from the tea. Wooden spoons by their nature are more insulating, and therefore they help to maintain the temperature of the tea. Now, you don't just pour it immediately. That is an absolute no-no. What you have to do is add your sugar to your teacup. Okay, look, here we are. That's it added. I add sugar first because it means that when you pour the tea, there is less necessity to stir the tea prior to adding milk if you choose to do so, because the process of pouring the tea into the cup automatically melts the sugar and infuses the sugar into the tea. Now, I added 2 lumps there, but my preference is actually for no lumps at all. So I'll leave 1 lump in just for continuity. Never, by the way, when you're having a British cup of tea, ask for 5 sugar lumps or 5 teaspoons of sugar and then insist that it's not stirred because you don't like your tea sweet, because that, my friends, unfortunately, is construed as taking the piss. Now we're ready to pour the tea. We've given it a couple of minutes to infuse and to, let's have a wee look and a smell. Ah, lovely. You're getting that combination of tannins, but you're also getting the floral, the fragrance, the range of aromas that you get from a skillfully blended group of individual leaf sources, which could be Darjeeling, Oolong. You know, tea is grown all over the world. Ceylon, another, Sri Lanka, another good example. So we're using the strainer now. Pouring the tea, as you can see, it's a kind of rich brown colour. Never make your tea too weak, because in Britain it shows lack of personality and character. Now, another thing that you may wish to have is your hot water jug. This is very important. Very important to have with your teapot, because when you go for your second cup of tea, you might want to add a little water, because the longer the tea leaves are in the teapot with the water, the stronger and more tannic the infusion. Now, another thing that you might like to consider, or you should expect with your traditional British cup of tea, is a tea cosy. Now, I've completely forgotten to bring a tea cosy out for this demonstration, so I'm going to have to improvise. So there we are, temporary tea cosy. Now, adding milk is a delicate matter. Increasingly, British people are choosing to have tea without milk, but traditionally it would be cow's milk would be added. I recommend that you add very gently to the side of the cup, add less than you think you would need, because the more milk you add, the more you dumb down the subtlety of the flavours coming from the tea leaf. Okay? Then finally, you stir the tea. You do not clink the cup. You stir 1, 2, 3, and then a tap on the side of the cup, and your tea is ready. How about that? It only remains for me now to taste this and give a kind of visual demonstration of how much I'm enjoying it. Lovely. I'll take my cap back now. And there you have it, my friends. A British traditional cup of tea. That if you are in Britain, it's something to rediscover, because it's all part of this increasing awareness of heritage. Talking of heritage, the British, a peculiar bunch of people, a real hodgepodge mongrel race, being a small island nation, eating a lot of fish over the generations, have been quite inventive. Engineering, science, astronomy, development, research, discovery, all that sort of stuff. Well, the British have been really quite good at it. From the magnificence of the steam railways to the Industrial Revolution and all the rest of it, the bottom line is we simply wouldn't have the sophistication of medicine, of technology, we would not have the internet, we wouldn't have relative, and I choose my words carefully, relative peaceful world. I mean, there are troubled areas, no doubt about it. I'm not trying to play that down, but compared to the constant level of open conflict, even 150 years ago, there is less of it generally. That is a good thing, and it's not brought about because the human race is particularly enlightened. It's been brought about because technology and science is showing us the greater world around us and forcing the human race to adapt and grow up. Engineers in particular have been a strong point of the British Isles. And that brings me neatly to my next co-subject, along with this traditional British cup of tea, and that is the Bloodhound SSC. SSC stands for supersonic car. And I am now going to annotate, there we go, right along the bottom there, the website that you can go to see all the wonderful, fantastic array of information about this British-based project. It's fascinating. Let me just give you a basically resume of it from my perspective, because as an online commentator, I am in fact, on our behalf, I've made a sponsored a donation to this project to help finance it and make it happen. Not too much, you'll be pleased to know, but enough to make a little bit of a difference. And part of not just donating to the project, but publicising and kind of enlarging people's awareness of this project. So imagine, if you will, a Formula One racing car that's been really stretched like a stretch limo. And then on top of it, you put the engine out of a Eurojet fighter. Quite a powerful engine, as you can imagine. And inside this stretched Formula One type car, you have a 800 horsepower V12 McLaren Formula One racing engine, which is acting as a fuel pump. And then on top of the jet engine, you have a space rocket, not designed to go into space, but designed to go horizontally along the surface of this planet. All good. You finish that off with the tail fin of an aircraft, and it's called the Bloodhound SSC. And this supersonic car has been designed by mainly, principally British engineers to attempt the world record for speed and land, fingers crossed, exceeding 1,000 miles per hour. Now, it's the same team a few years ago with a supersonic car called Thrust, which had two jet engines basically attached to the side of a kind of rocket car that achieved over 730 miles an hour and set the last land speed world record. It's a British tradition. And what they're wanting to do is get past 1,000 miles an hour. Now, as you can imagine, as you get faster, the stresses get greater. The amount of energy required, the force required, is so much more than even at 700 miles per hour, considerably more. And what's interesting is that they've developed specific technologies for this world record achievement. I'm saying achievement, I mustn't preempt it, for this world record attempt. And it's an open source. It's not kind of all pasted with copyrights and secret contracts and all the rest of it. It's educational. Schools are involved all around the world. You know, they've cleared an area in South Africa that's going to be the runway for the supersonic car, and it stands in the Guinness World Book of Records as the largest ever area of land cleared by human hand, ever. The Bonneville Salt Flats in Arizona are actually not big enough and of the right level to accommodate the requirements of this supersonic car. It really is amazing. The amount of engineering, redesigning, ingenuity that's gone into this, phenomenal. So we wish them well. I mean, the space rocket, my motorbike generates on average 86 brake horsepower, and it goes pretty damn fast, quite fast enough for me. But the space rocket attached to the Bloodhound SSC is going to generate roughly 75,000 brake horsepower. Extraordinary amounts of power. In fact, if you sat the car on end and lit the fuse or press the red button or whatever they do to start it, it would go straight up into the air like a rocket. At 17,000 feet, it would break the sound barrier and it would stop rising about 25,000 feet in the air. That is the amount of explosive power that is going to be delivered through injecting liquid nitrogen, because there's not enough oxygen, in the air to ignite this. You know, they're actually injecting liquid oxygen into a rubber composite because rubber burns at such high temperatures and so hot, to create the push to get this vehicle in excess of 1,000 miles per hour. There's lots of videos on YouTube. Please go and check it out, because it's excellent. It really is. It's what humans do very well. Innovate, create, build, develop. And it's contributing just a little bit, just a tiny little bit, to the long-term survival of the human race. Just my opinion. Time for a cup of tea, and I'll let you folks head off and have a look at all the wonderful videos on YouTube about the Bloodhound SSC, and have a look at the website. And you may want to donate yourself, because you can buy badges and you can buy models and things, and all the funds are going towards developing this technology and support the team that are making all this happen. In fact, the perfect accompaniment to a traditional British cup of tea. I hope you'll come back again to Ralphie.com for my next review, where I will be returning to my usual and familiar subject for review. This has been a little bit different. I hope you've enjoyed the difference, and I hope you will appreciate even more differences as we continue to explore this great blue ship which sails around the mighty sun. And as the saying goes, joy to everyone who sails along. Toot toot!